Greetings, students. In this brief lesson, we'll talk about the ethics of drug use and drug abuse. Should drugs be criminalized or legalized? That's the question to which we set ourselves for the next few minutes. All right, here's what we're going to do. First, I'm going to present an opening of sorts, and if we were in class, we would do a survey. I'll talk more about that in a second. Then we're going to do some definitions, clarifications, and then we'll go over the arguments for legalizing drugs, and then the arguments against legalization. And then we'll talk about liberty-limiting principles. When is it okay for a government to limit the liberty of its citizens? We'll talk about four principles, four arguments people have used for when that is okay. All right. If we were in class right now, I would ask you to get out a sheet of paper and write down the drugs you've used this week, this year, or ever. And I would have another student tally the results. I would not see who wrote what, but I'm always curious which drugs are popular and which ones are new, which ones are slipping out of favor. And it's always interesting. Usually, at least half the class has used marijuana or cannabis this year. Usually most of the class has used it ever, but about half have used it this year, and usually about a quarter of the students have used it this week. And then from there it only goes further, right? You can have some of the harder drugs. In every class you'll have a student or two who has done some really hard drugs. Interestingly, though, a lot of students will ask, when I tell them to write down which drugs you've used, they'll say, well, do prescription drugs count? Well, does alcohol count? Does tobacco count? Do cigarettes count, for instance? And this raises the question of what counts as a drug, what counts as drug use, and what counts as drug abuse. That's part of the question we intend to answer today. Because, as I'm going to define the term, drug use and drug abuse can be any non-medicinal use of a drug, but more on that in a second. All right, so here's the question for discussion. If we were in class, I would ask, should marijuana be legalized for recreational use? Why? Or why not? And some of you would answer, it has great medical effects, it can reduce stress, it helps with PTSD. Others of you would say, no, it should not be legalized because it gives people an easy way out. It helps them not face their problems. It can lead to harder drugs, etc. And so we would have this debate if we were in class. And most students in the college age right now believe marijuana should be legalized for recreational use. Medicinal marijuana is pretty much legal almost everywhere now. Most students believe it should be legalized for recreational use. It gets more controversial, and many fewer students believe that harder drugs should be legalized for recreational use. For instance, obviously most students believe that heroin should continue to be illegal. Most students believe cocaine should continue to be illegal. And we would talk about why. Why should marijuana be legalized, but not some of these quote-unquote harder drugs? What is it about hard drugs that's different than marijuana? If we are making illegal anything with addictive-like potential, that's one argument. If we are making legal anything that should be the decision of a person with respect to his or her own body, that's a different sort of argument. So this is the question we would have if we were discussing this in an actual classroom. All right, preliminary remarks. I would ask that each student in the classroom, if we're having this, be respectful of each other. Don't hesitate to speak up, because there are, believe it or not, there are actually still some conservative students who would argue that, all drugs should remain illegal, including marijuana. And that is becoming an increasingly minority viewpoint. And yet I would encourage those students to speak up. But here are some of the questions we need to consider. Should the state take a role in preventing people from harming themselves? Presumably everyone who would vote to keep illegal the harder drugs just mentioned, thinks that the state has a role in preventing people from harming themselves. A second question, which drugs should be legalized, if any, and which should remain illegal? And then finally, which of the liberty-limiting principles should be used in this debate? That's something we'll come to towards the end of the lesson. All right, now let's do some definitions. By the way, if you have not seen Breaking Bad, you are really missing out. It shows the effect of having an illegal market for drugs, and one character goes from being a relatively decent guy to just brutal by the end. All right, how do we define these things? What's the difference between a drug and a non-drug? What's the difference between drug use and drug abuse? And then finally, what's the difference between drug abuse and full-on drug addiction? First, let's talk about drug. How do you define drug? Well, for our purposes, we're going to define it this way. A drug is a psychoactive chemical that's transported to the brain via the bloodstream, influencing consciousness directly and significantly. Now, notice about this definition, it does include alcohol. It does include nicotine. It does include tobacco. It does include even caffeine, coffee, right? And this shows that drugs can serve medical but also non-medical uses. No one gets up in arms when I'm drinking a cup of coffee as I narrate this lesson, right? There are many uses for drugs: medicine, recreation, religion, to stimulate creativity, etc. That is how we're going to define drug. Now, drug use becomes drug abuse when it goes a step beyond regular use. This is any non-medical use of a drug that carries serious risk of significant harm to oneself or others. So for instance, if I'm drinking this cup of coffee now, that doesn't carry serious risk of significant harm to myself or anyone else. Now, about this definition, it includes any illegal use of drugs, and that could range from, you know, weed to cocaine, etc. It also includes legal drugs like alcohol if it is used in excess. So for instance, it's one thing to drink a beer. It's another thing to drink a six-pack, and it is quite another thing to drink a case, right? That is when drug use becomes drug abuse. Now, finally, most serious is drug addiction. And if we were in class, I would ask you to raise your hand if you knew an addict. And we would talk, without mentioning any specifics or any names, we would talk about what it is like to live with an addict. Right? This is the most serious. There is a high degree of physical or psychological dependency, and if the addict is denied their drug of choice, there are severe withdrawal symptoms and often relapse. So this is drug addiction. These are the kinds of things we're trying to stop, but there are vastly different perspectives on how we can stop drug addiction in the United States. Some will suggest, for instance, that we adopt a more European approach. And we'll talk about these various perspectives in a second. But one of the underlying questions is this: should substances with addictive potential, like drugs, be criminalized? Now, most of us would probably say, well, yeah, of course. Anything that could become addictive to someone should be criminalized. And yet, when you start to get into the weeds of that, what types of substances are potentially addictive, we would outlaw things that we don't want to outlaw, like Oreos, right? This is an older article now, but it talks about why Oreos are as addictive as cocaine to your brain, right? If potentially addictive substances are outlawed, then we're going to have to outlaw Oreos. Then we're going to have to outlaw fatty pieces of meat. Then we're going to have to outlaw anything else that people really love. We might even have to outlaw coffee, right? All right, so let's get into the arguments for legalization. The primary argument, and this is the one you don't hear actually as much coming from college students, they'll talk about the medicinal benefits of cannabis, but you don't hear this article much, which is a shame because it is the most powerful argument for legalization. And it has to do with this word, autonomy. Now, if we were to break up the word autonomy, basically we're asking who owns you. If you have autonomy from two Greek words, nomos meaning law and autos meaning the self or you or, you know, it is to be a law unto oneself. So if you're going to ask who owns you, do you own yourself or don't you? Think about it. If you went to Home Depot or Lowe's and bought a shovel and brought it home and started digging in your front yard, and someone came along, walking along the sidewalk and said to you, "Oh, I'm sorry, you can't do that." You'd say, "Well, I can't do what?" "I'm sorry, you can't use your shovel like that." "Well, why not? It's my shovel and it's my property." If they were to continue to tell you, you can't use your property in the way that you see fit when you are the owner, you would feel like that's a violation. They have no right to do that. Well, the same argument for legalization says that you own your body. You are free to do with it what you want. Right? Is this a free society or not? In a free society, people make their own decisions, even if those decisions are not going to be in their best interest with respect to their health. Right? All right, a second argument for legalization is the social utility argument. And this argument basically says we could spend our money a lot better. Instead of this drug war, instead of us wasting millions and millions of dollars every year as a country, let's spend our money on rehabilitation facilities. This is the European model. In Norway, in Portugal, for instance, they have spent their money on rehab facilities and drug addiction has plummeted since they've done that. So there's a social utility argument for legalization in that if we were going to spend this money, rather than spending it to fight drugs, which is potentially a never-ending and pointless fight, let's spend our money to fight addiction instead. And thirdly, you could argue for legalization on the grounds that most people are fine with the legalization of marijuana. 60 to 70% of Americans favor the legalization of recreational marijuana. Most of them, overwhelmingly, they support medicinal marijuana, but most of them favor recreational use as well. Now, popular opinion does not always mean moral, right? There are many times when the popular opinion was of one mindset and morality, we can see in retrospect, would have demanded the different mindset. But it is worth at least mentioning that popular opinion is on the side of legalizing recreational use of marijuana. Here are two charts that kind of suggest this. The U.S. public opinion on legalizing marijuana from 1969, where only 12% believed it should be legal, to 2018, where 62% believed it should be illegal. Similarly, 84% in 1969 thought it should be illegal, down to 34% in 2018. Percentage of people who say marijuana should be made legal, among the millennial generation, 74% should say it should be made legal. Gen X, 63%. Even the boomers, over half of them, 54%, believe marijuana should be made legal. So that's the public opinion. Now, Michael Humer, in his article, America's Unjust Drug War, says the following, and this is the autonomy argument. He says, quote, "The idea of a right to use drugs derives from the idea that individuals own their own bodies. That is, a person has the right to exercise control over his own body, including the right to decide how it should be used, and to exclude others from using it in a manner similar to the way one may exercise control over one's other property. We may not use our bodies to harm others in certain ways, just as we may not use our property to harm others. But drug use seems to be a paradigm case of a legitimate exercise of the right to control one's own body." That's the autonomy argument. Here's the social utility argument from Ethan Nadelman. He says the war on drugs is lost. Quote, "Drugs are here to stay. The time has come to abandon the concept of a drug-free society. We need to focus on learning to live with drugs in such a way that they do the least possible harm." That's harm reduction. Quote, "There is a wide range of choice in drug policy options between the free market approach and the zero tolerance approach. These options fall under the concept of harm reduction. That concept holds that drug policies need to focus on reducing harm whether engendered by drugs or by the prohibition of drugs. And it holds that disease and death can be diminished even among people who can't or won't stop taking the drugs. Now, the National Review is a conservative publication, and so that lets you know even some conservatives are suggesting there is a social utility argument to be made for legalization. How would that look? Here are three versions of legalization. Thomas Sasse argues that we should have a free market on all drugs, just like in that European model that we talked about before. Another version of legalization would be to have the government own the means of production and regulate it and sell it themselves, just like they do with driver's licenses or fire departments. A third version of legalization is that the government and the private corporations could work together. And this, I think, is what they've done in the states where recreational marijuana has been legalized. So what do you think of these? Are there advantages to each of these approaches, each of these versions of legalization? Are there disadvantages? Think it through. We would talk about it if we were in class. All right, so what are the arguments against legalization? Again, I would ask the students who know an addict to raise their hand, and I would ask you, is the addict that you know free to not indulge in their addiction? And most of you would say, for the true addict, they have no freedom left. They have given their freedom to the drug, and now they are not free to decide how to use their body. In fact, they are a slave to their drug. So that is a powerful argument that autonomy is not what's at stake here. That an addict truly isn't free, and that's why we should keep it illegal. A second argument is that if we make drugs legal, there will be a big business that arises out of it. And this is basically making money off of other people's pain and suffering. This is an argument that Patrick Kennedy makes in his, I forget what year it was, he had a mental health and parity bill in Congress. And he suggests that if we legalize marijuana, there are going to be people, you know, making a lot of money off of others' pain and suffering, because companies, and this is true in the cannabis industry, companies are primarily profiting from daily users. And those are the people who buy the most. Those are the people who, you know, they create their products for. That's their bread and butter. And that's the big business of addiction, making money off of other people's pain and suffering. A third argument against legalizing it, or for criminalizing it, is a common sense argument. And I knew a student once who, I guess there's no other way to say this other than he got high so often that when he had to stop smoking weed, like, he said he wanted to rip his eyes out. He said he wanted to pull his own hair out. Like, he was just high all the time. And it kind of shows that there's something wrong with the need to get high all the time, isn't there? That's just a basic common sense approach to living your life. If you need a substance like this, or else you want to rip your eyes out, you know, there's something wrong with that. And then finally, although this may have been basically debunked in the last several years, some people view marijuana, at least, as a gateway drug to other harder drugs. I think that this is a controversial idea. It used to be more popular than it is now because there are plenty of people who stop with cannabis. Like, this is the only drug that they'll use. And yet, that idea is still out there, so I wanted to mention it. All right, now let's talk about whether or not it's the job of the state to decide how people use their own bodies and to decide which products they are and are not allowed to use. A liberty-limiting principle is any law or an idea that limits the freedom or liberty of a consenting adult. So, for instance, if I wanted to, ride a motorcycle, in some states, I would have to wear a helmet. That limits my freedom or liberty to ride without a helmet on public roads, right? That would be a liberty-limiting principle based on the idea that I was going to harm myself if I crashed. So when does this happen? In four situations. We've already talked about harming oneself. That's known as legal paternalism. But the most popular of these is the harm principle, or harming others. Most people believe if you're going to harm other people, you should not be free to do that. A third one is legal moralism, which says the government should get involved to prevent people from acting immorally. And a fifth one is the offense principle, that the state should be involved with preventing profound offense to others. And by the way, these four liberty-limiting principles come from a wonderful social and political philosopher named Joel Feinberg. And he had a four-part, a series of books in the 1980s and 1990s on liberty-limiting principles. And he finds himself a member of the liberal tradition, meaning he wants to give people liberty, not the political use of liberty, but the liberal tradition, meaning promoting or maximizing liberty. So how do these relate to the drug issue? Which of them apply to drug legalization or criminalization? Well, it's safe to say that these three apply. The offense principle doesn't really apply because I don't know that people get offended by other people using drugs, but it is an issue of harming others, harming oneself, and some people view it as an issue of preventing immorality. So how do we reduce harm? Most people, most ethicists accept the harm principle. I don't know a single one that doesn't, actually. They say if you want to harm others, you should not be free to do that. But there is profound disagreement on how to reduce harm. Some people say you reduce harm by making drugs legal. If you decriminalize them, if you have needle exchanges, if you reduce the costs of fighting drugs, increase the quality of the drugs so that they're not laced with something else, making it legal is the way to reduce harm, according to these people. Other people will argue, however, that the harms are too great by making drugs legal. And they say, you know, there's profound abuse and neglect of families and children, that the harms of a drug addicted person are much greater than the harms of, you know, keeping it illegal. So there's a difference, there's a different perspective based on which side you're on how to reduce harm on this issue. All right, how about legal paternalism? This is the idea that the state should intervene to protect people from themselves. It is as if citizens are three-year-olds running out to the street and the state acts as a concerned parent running after their child to grab their hand right before they go in the street so that they don't hurt themselves. So here's the argument. Drugs hurt citizens. The government should protect its people. Therefore, the government should protect against drugs, which hurt citizens. Now, the criticism to legal paternalism is this idea of autonomy. Don't we have a right to self-determination, right? John Stuart Mill thought, legal paternalism, if you're going to do something that harms yourself, you should have an absolute right to do that in his book on liberty. And yet, you could argue that people who are in the throes of addiction are not exercising liberty, as we mentioned before. This is Mill's argument against voluntary slavery. It goes like this. By selling himself for a slave, he abdicates his liberty. He foregoes any future use of it beyond that single act. He therefore defeats, in his own case, the very purpose which is the justification of allowing him to dispose of himself. The principle of freedom cannot require that he should be free and not to be free. It is not freedom to be allowed to alienate his freedom. These reasons, the force of which is so conspicuous in this peculiar case, are evidently of far wider applications. In other words, if someone wants to voluntarily give up their freedom, Mill is going to actually say you should not be free to do that. That's how important freedom is, that you should not give up your freedom, should not be able to. How about legal moralism? Well, this liberty-limiting principle prevents against immorality. If you're going to do something that's immoral, the government should step in and say you shouldn't be allowed to do that. This, for instance, would be why some people favor stricter rules against gambling, or rules against doing certain sexual things, right? It's the idea that the government has a say in what you do if it's immoral. And so here's the argument. Drug use is immoral. The government should limit immorality. Therefore, the government should limit drugs. Now, you could argue against this point of view by pointing out to a potential inconsistency. There's no significant difference between some legal and illegal drugs, right? Why, for instance, is marijuana illegal recreationally in a lot of places in the United States while opioids are legal, right? Why is marijuana illegal while hard liquor is legal? They can have equally drastic results, and yet one is legal and one is illegal. There's no significant difference between some legal and illegal drugs. Now, the response to that, of course, is that some drugs are beyond recreational use. Some drugs are so powerful and so harmful that they destroy a person's humanity. And anyone who has known a hardcore addict knows that this is absolutely true. It is sad, and it's tragic. And some drugs are that powerful and deserve to be seriously legislated, argue those who support legal moralism as a legitimate liberty-limiting principle. All right, so if we were in class, we would talk about the drugs you've used this week, this year, and ever. We would have the survey results. And I take the survey also to suggest that anyone who is currently struggling with a substance is not alone. There was a TED Talk recently called Everything You Think You Know About Addiction Is Wrong, in which the speaker talked about how they gave drugs to rats. And the rats that were in cages with other rats who had social connections were much less likely to develop an addiction to the drug they were giving it than the rats who were isolated. The rats who were isolated had a much higher rate of addiction. And I think the speaker is using this to gesture towards the value of our social bonds. You're not alone. And if you are struggling with something, you can change. You can come out of the shadows. You can come out of hiding. You can get the help you need. And if I can help in any way, please let me know. Thank you for watching this brief lesson on drugs, whether we should criminalize or legalize them, and which ones should be criminalized, which ones should not be criminalized. If you have any comments or questions, I'm happy to talk about this further. And thank you for watching.